Good morning. We are about to start the third day of the conference. It is my pleasure to welcome you today as well, and I hope that by now you made a lot of contacts with each other and that you also enjoyed yesterday's visit, which I think it was very interesting. So my role today, before we start with the sessions, which are going to be, I promise, very interesting, is try to get us back into what was discussed yesterday and try to see whether we can make sense of it. There was a lot of information on the table, very different, in a way very scattered, and I think it has been difficult to put it together, and I like to thank very much the two reporters in the conference, which you may not have met them, but they are both back there, Maite and Carlos Mario, who are doing an excellent job of trying to make sense of everything we are doing here. Okay, so the two issues we discussed is really making the business case for integrated energy, water planning and investment. So we look at how research and technology can do something about, you know, making the case for integrated planning and investment, whether companies can do that, the private sector, and what are the government's responses. And we look at, you know, how, what the U.S. is doing and what the Dutch government was doing and all this work that the UNEC is doing with governments. We also looked at the industry partnerships to ensure water and energy efficiencies, and we looked at you know, the industries as a unit, as a unit of production, how they are improving in a combined way water and energy efficiency. And we also had some lessons learned from public-private partnerships, mainly from coming, you know, from the leadership of the energy sector. I think so it was a little bit of a combination between industries as a user and then energy providers. Those were the two types that we had yesterday. I think for one of the, so I'm trying to just to highlight some messages. I'm not trying to do a summary, I can promise, okay, don't worry. But just some ideas that maybe help us, you know, understand that we're having a conversation here in the conference, and that there is some ideas that are starting to come through. And some ideas are partly of what we discussed the first day, Kathleen, so that's useful. One of the things is that cooperation through partnerships is not an option between water and energy. And I know some people may be still skeptical whether that's possible or that's useful or whether that's a must. So that's something that we can further discuss today. I think, you know, for the evidence yesterday, it seemed that governments need technological and business partners. You know, a lot of what has been happening in the water and energy nexus is driven by the industry, is driven by business, is driven, and you know, that information needs to come through and flow through to governments. There is no obvious technical solutions. I think that was clear. You know, some solutions are good for something and they are worse for something else, and you just really have to make sure that you understand the trade-offs and what you're doing. So maybe some things will cost you more for the environment and it will be better for improving access. So you really need to be aware of those. And so there is no one, I think several people say this, and I know that we repeat this in the UN all the time, and nobody knows exactly what it means, but there is no one size fits all. But basically, I think the message there is that we have to be more careful about looking at the context and what, where are we. And I think that's the real message there. The question of whether there are complex technology choices, there was a lot of conversation there about technology yesterday. But maybe what at the end of the day, my impression is that there was not that complex when we focus on the right choices. So maybe, you know, really depends on what we are doing. For example, the idea of water consumption and withdrawal, that there was so much discussion about the difference in the energy sector, really depends on the type of cooling system. Nothing can be said a priori about the best cooling systems or location, water abundance and reliability, incentives. So what is best for different places, it will depend on how much water there is, obviously, and what are the sources of energy which are available. So don't think that because, you know, there is a good solution in the U.S., everybody has to do it, or because there is a good solution in Germany. So the question is that we need to look at the resource endowment, you know, what is there, what is in the different places. So technology choices are open, and water use is really a matter of business and policy choices. So we had this idea that from water intensive through dry cooling and hybrid systems in between. I think this idea of hybrid systems, it was very interesting. I don't know how you feel about that. I think our colleague from the US is not here yet. But I think this idea that you can have more adaptive technology depending even on the time in the year, you know, when there is times in the year or whether there's a dry period and a wet period, that you can have these hybrid systems, and you can have cooling systems which are more water intensive in some periods, and you can have dry systems in periods which are not wet. And also we had these examples from Abengoa on affordable energy for developing and arid countries. So I think there was some conversation about this idea of the lock-in. You know, innovations are needed to address lock-in issues and prevent rebound effects. I think this idea that we are locked into energy solutions already, and you know, we have so much investments in this that doesn't allow us to come out and think about other energy options and other water options. So that was something that I think it did come through in terms of this idea of innovation, because you have the innovation, but at the same time you have all these investments already that you need to do something with it, and all the countries are doing this. So we had this idea that for example, from BP, the project in Australia, that the local knowledge is essential. So this idea that just look at what happens there. And also from India and South Africa, it was, you know, in the UNDP UNEP session, it was very clear that there was a mismatch. You have to really look at the energy choice and what happens in relation to these lock-in effects. There was also something interesting about how water scarcity is a driver for energy innovation. And so, for example, just giving an example down in the bottom in my slide. So the energy cost might be a driver for innovation in the water sector. And there was a case that you didn't see, but it was here in the side event in Spain, how natural pressurized delivery of water for irrigation in Spain has been triggered by the fact that the energy costs have increased for farmers. And also water costs might be a driver of innovation in the energy sector, and I think there was good examples here in the USA and South Africa. So the pricing issue, it came to the table. You know, how we price energy, how we price water, that was also part of the conversation. And part of the conversation also, Catherine, was back to governance. You know, some of the points you made at the very first day. The critical role of water governing institutions and the issue of viability. There was quite a lot of emphasis being made in the UNIDO session about how you need any of these innovations or any of these efficiency gains to be viable for companies. And I think the back to governance, I think we had a very, very strong point from our US colleague about the importance of properly enforced water property rights as a precondition to make sustainable choices in the energy sector. If we don't have that's a problem. And I think many people were commenting on your presentation after the event, so you know, it was really interesting. So, for example, there was examples in relation to fracking, you know, that if fracking companies have the right incentives, they will do their best to minimize water consumption. So there was some conversation about that. Water scarcity signals might push the irrigated biofuels back as a viable energy source. You know, if there is water scarcity and there is the right prices, maybe, you know, biofuels will go back to what role they can have. And again, there was some discussion that some countries, biofuels may make sense because they have a lot of water anyway, but in other countries may not make so much sense. Okay. Also, I think there was a very strong message about that partnerships are a marathon rather than a sprint. And so don't think that you're going to... I don't know whether you heard, but the US case was very clear. They've been working together with governments for how many? 20 years there was? I mean, there was a long process. And so I think don't try to make too much too soon, but capitalizing the attractiveness of the first easy steps. But recognizing that all the partners will have self-interest, I think that was part of my question also to the panel here. And also that the idea that you have to have a stable regulatory frameworks to drive innovation, I think that's something that sounds very true for the water sector as well. You know, we all need this stable regulatory frameworks, otherwise we cannot operate in any countries. And I think we had this nice this nice idea about partnerships that, for example, in the case of the hydropower sustainable assessment protocol, the idea that the partnerships were creating this legitimacy to their work. You know, once they produced it, they went into this wider partnerships, and that allowed them both to scale up and also to legitimate the product. So that was part of the partnership benefits, if you want. There was quite a lot of conversations about the role of the public incentives in promoting new partnerships and innovation. So we had, I don't know whether he's here, AIP Waters, so saying that there is money, but don't rely too much on that money. I mean, there was two conversations here, I don't know whether you noticed, when the UNIDO Carlsberg case, it was very clear that it was made viable by the fact that they had this big GEF project behind it, and that allowed them to really push forward. On the other hand, you had the European Union saying there is some money there, but there is, you know, it needs to be also interested for the partners themselves. You know, the money coming from outside is not enough. I think that was more or less my. Of course, you may disagree, and I'll be very happy to hear from you if you don't. So, because these things will go into the conference conclusions. So, if you might have some comments on that would be great. Then just moving a little bit more, although I'm mixing, as you see, all the presentation, is that we from the UNEP session, I think we got a very clear message that don't look only at the technical issues. I think they were reacting to the fact that we were talking too much about technical solutions, so Alice, you will be happy about that. And that energy and water efficiency is much more than that, and we need to open it up. And I think that links very well also to what UNIDO said. And I think that also links to the first presentation at the beginning, Kathleen, when you were talking about the multiple parameters that you have to attain with water and energy nexus. So that was part of it also, the conversation yesterday with UNIDO on how they see it, that you really need to see this as much more complex, multiple of objectives. We also talk about the scaling up, and UNIDO told us that the scaling up, there is some rules of the game to scaling up. And they have a little bit of like a protocol on how to try to make all the work that they have been doing transferable. And again, link sustainability to financial gains, benchmarking company performance, training and monitoring, and follow a flexible approach depending on the company size and baseline, and again, enabling financial incentives. So I think that was more or less their protocol or their guidelines to ensure that some of these good practices were being scaled up. We discussed about information. I don't know, my colleague from South Africa is here, but we also talk about there are still many information gaps. Many times, you know, but that there is always this issue. We always want more information. So to what extent do you have more information? But it's clearly that in this case, you know, it seems to me that energy companies are investing in water accounting, so it must say something. You know, it must say something that they really need this information and they need it better. So there is some information gaps. There was also some issues about which kind of models we have. Again, you know, like we had in the first day, and whether these are good enough and whether they are sensitive to water prices, but maybe not to water shortages. So there is a number of things that people want to see better, and how they consider water as an emission rather than a carrier. So I think that's something that we need to improve. And again, it came all the conversation about the difference between water consumption and withdrawal, and what do we do with this? And this intensity of measuring the water intensity of the different processes was also something important. So good news that some of the concepts are coming back and the people are concerned about them. And then now, that's for the content. And probably you heard much more and you had many more ideas that came out from yesterday. So the idea is just to come back here and make sure that all the messages that were discussed yesterday still stay in our brains and we can relate it also to what we will be discussing today. Today we will be discussing about local partnerships on water and energy, and we will be discussing about policy research and innovation partnerships for water and energy. The first session will have two panels. The first panel will be led by Aquafed, who will be here in a second, Jack Moss. And we will have two interesting cases, which I will let you present them. And the second panel is led by E. Clay, Barbara Anton, who is also here, and we'll discuss about partnerships of local and subnational authorities, a little bit more focus on improving household consumption, but not only, no, as I understand. We again have a side event of half an hour about the World Water Week, and we have Siwi here, so thank you very much for that. And I think we have the Sustainable for All initiative also, who are going to partner with them. The afternoon, again, we have two panels, one on policy research. I think my colleague Adil, Safar Adil, makes sense that we still need to know more about this linkage, that we don't know enough and we don't know how to explain it enough, so maybe we deal with that. And also about what innovation partnerships exist, so more relation to technology, but not only. We will end up at 6 trying to, the UN people who are here, we will try to give you our feedback of the sense we have made of everything you have said. So let's try to make sure that we can take some things, and we will not be able to say everything that has been said, but at least we will try to make sense and see how we can take some of this to the World Water Day. And finally, there is again a side event on Spain, on how, not on the Nexus challenges, but on the Nexus management, so how they are managing the Nexus. And they are inviting us after that. They are inviting us for dinner outside. So if you want to stay, so that you will have dinner. In a way, it's an incentive for you to stay. It's an incentive. Okay, so I didn't want to go today into the specifics of the objectives and of the sessions, because you are going to do it. So I think I will try to do that. So that's all from me. I don't know if you have any comments, questions. I will just, we proceed to the session that everybody is looking forward to it.